All right. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining. Thank you guys for joining us today. We'll get started here in just a couple of moments. If you've got any questions, feel free to put them in the chat, put them in the Q&A. We can start putting some eyes on them, and we'll see what we can do for you. But again, I'm just super appreciative that you joined the session today. So if you just want to listen in, that is fine as well. Again, if you've got your questions, if you've already pre-submitted a question in some capacity, feel free to let me know that you pre-submitted it and I'll go find it. Hide that. You don't need to see that. Sorry about that. Yeah, feel free to let me know. Any questions we got? I have one thing I'll show you that I know you haven't heard about yet, that you can learn about because it's brand new. But we'll get started here. I don't know, maybe about 60 seconds, 90 seconds, something like that. All right, we'll get started here in about 60 seconds. If you have a question, feel free to pre-submit it. If you don't, I'll show you some stuff that I've been learning about lately, and we can still learn while we're lunching. All right, we're at a decent time, 12:04. So here's what we're going to do. Thank you guys for joining again. Everyone that's been in this lobby has been in here before. So you've heard my spiel about YouTube. You've heard the sh spiel about the Decision Solutions Marketplace. Here's a spiel you haven't heard. We have a new thing, just dropped, fresh out the gate. If you go to, I'm not sure where it exists on our website. I'll have to find that. Maybe we can do that together. But I'll just tell you the URL, docbot. Dotdecisions.com, right? Docbot.decisions.com. I just found out about it this morning. I think it's brand new. We do have some documentation people in the lobby. They might be able to tell me more about it, but it's a language model we train using our documentation site. So you could put some stuff in here like, how can I create an account and adjust permissions, right? We'll send that in. Give it a moment to think. And we'll get some really cool information here in just a moment. But it is a just another resource for you if you're trying to learn, if you're trying to find some information. It will kind of parse through that for us. I'm not sure about how long this might take because, again, this is brand new. Like I said, I just found out about it this morning and I work here. So hopefully we get some type of question. I know just charting, it'll kind of give you some graphics as well. Let's see if it can kind of populate something for us. While that's loading, I'll load up my local host and see if we can get any information here. Look at this. Wow. So there's that information for you. You know, it took about 60 seconds, you know, 90 seconds, but it does kind of give you some file path type stuff. Here's what I'll do as well. I'll pull it up off screen though. I'm going to just for fun, and we'll let it load while I talk about some other new things I've been learning about until we kind of get some questions in the chat. I'm going to feed it some information based on previous questions we've gotten in the lunch and learns and see how well it goes. Yeah. And then we'll talk about some new stuff that we've been kind of building out here. So here's a question we got on the 12th, which was last week. I'll kind of paste it in there. I would like to calculate the completeness of the participant profile using a rule table. What is the most efficient way to do that? That's super ambiguous, so we're going to give it a lot of time to think. But let's just see if it can find us some information there. While that's building out, and again, if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat or the QA, and I can work in that way. But otherwise, I'll just show you what I've been learning and what I've been working on. And hopefully, you can see the value and kind of that kind of stuff. So while we're loading up over here, let's talk about this rule collection filter, right? So I was tasked with kind of making some content around the rule collection filter, because it is one of those things that is a little bit misleading in its simplicity. And we've had customers and deployments and repository issues with these rule collection filters and collection filters broadly. Here is the big underlying kind of catch that you need to know about this rule collection filter. And I'll actually make a new project here so I don't break the one that I have working. Actually, I already have one that's broken. So let's find that. Delete me. Nice. Awesome. So let's say I'm going to create a flow. And as you can see, I've done this a bunch. And I'm going to call this rule collection filter. Here's what you need to know. A couple things, right? You've probably seen this before. You can make a rule to kind of parse through data. So rule, collection, filter. All right. Nope. I just added the flow that I named the same thing. That's what happened there. This right here is that flow in delete me. So because I named this flow the same thing as the step, that's why that showed up. It was an oversight on my end. All right. Look, there we go. We actually got some information. Complete participant profile using a rule table. And again, this is a relatively simple approach to it, but if you want to play around and have some fun, docbot.decisions.com, it can give you some information. I'll just keep running these back in the background. I doubt it'll give me this. Because that's a tough question to ask a bot, but we'll see if it runs in the background here because we are having fun on this, Wednesday afternoon? All right. So with a rule collection filter, here's what you really need to know. Yes, you probably know you can filter by different data types. You can filter complex types. I can show that if you'd like. You map the input. But here's the catch that people get into some trouble with, right? Is that when I go up here and I make the rule, or if I'm just using a straight up collection filter, which if I just use a straight up collection filter, which makes a flow rather than a rule, the thing that you need to know is that this rule called rule collection filter step one rule, right? Entity, you know, whatever, doesn't matter. This stuff doesn't particularly matter. Is the entity entity? Sure. I love that logic. The entity is the entity. Here's what the important part that you need to know is that it actually makes these rules and flows as individual elements in decisions that need to be migrated with the project when you choose to migrate that flow or that flow that contains that step to another project or to various instances of decisions. So let's prove that. In here, I've got these flows, right? Just two flows I've made. That's it. But if I go up to folder view and show hidden all folder items with hidden, I have all of those rules and flows that are parented by these flows. So if I choose to just move a single filter to another project or something like that, it might not have access to that rule anymore. And then you get yourself into problems. So that is also shown on our documentation site for this rule, but it's not very clearly described. So if I go to step index, which is a good place to find, you know, just stuff on rules, rule, I think it's just called collection steps on here, collection filter steps. It does say it right here. The flow or rule created by this step to filter the list is stored in the folder view report by changing the report view to include hidden items. So that is included on there. But just, you know, that's something to be aware of in that kind of world here. I got a question. Let's go, VT. I'll close out one more thing with this, and then we'll jump over to that and see if we can resolve it, or I can at least look on our internal search sites and see if it's a common thing that we've seen before. The last thing I want to show you real fast, I think, is a really cool and powerful part of these rule collection filters, just because I can close it out with something more positive than just like, hey, here's stuff to be careful about. Here's something to be excited about, as they would say. Generally speaking, with your rule collection filter, if you go into edit, you're really only going to have access to the entity unless you click this expose flow data. And what that allows you to do is take all of these outputs of the various elements in your flow, all the flow data, as they would say, your given inputs, and you can assess those as a part of your rule collection filter. So rather than saying the entity starts with, you can make things a lot more dynamic. So in this particular capacity, I have all these unit tests set up already. I made a ton of unit tests. I have countries, I have states, I have vehicles, right? And what I can do is using that expose flow data and using those variables in my rule, right? When I run a debug with one of those unit tests, I can run a form and say, hey, I want to filter by the letter A based on this form. And then dynamically, that is the data input collection. That is the data I'm going to get out from the form. So outside of that rule, I'm populating that. Or I could say, hey, I just want all countries. I could say, hey, I just want all the data, right? And that will fulfill checkbox is true. So it just gives you a way, a lot more strength to those filters. All right. So let's move on to some questions. And thank you guys so much for joining. If you just joined, we've been kind of talking about decisions docbot. Hey, look, it even answered that. So if you're just joining, we have this docbot.decisions.com. I've been typing in random questions, kind of letting it run in the background. And it's giving us a lot of kind of, relatively concise information. Or at least steps on how you can resolve some of those questions. So again, that's docbot.decisions.com. I've asked it three questions and various levels of kind of depth from creating an account. It gave me all the information. Working with rule tables gave me the information, and then how to set up QuickBooks. It even says, hey, we have a module. We have a QuickBooks module. So it did do that for us, which is an awesome, awesome, awesome tool. I'll keep kind of feeding it some questions, let it run in the background. So I'll start by just feeding it the question that we got in the chat, and you guys can read it while I think about it and while I parse it. We'll see what it has to say. And we'll just feed it in its exact wording. I'm gonna make that spelling CK editor, CRE editor. I doubt it will give us this one, but hey, we're trying to figure it out here together. So the question, as you can read here, is I start to see a weird red warning when I do something in merge text editor. It says CK editor's version is not secure. Oh, I do know this one. Consider updating to version XXX. Have you seen this? Yes. And can we fix it without a decisions version update? I do believe so to both of those. I have seen it. I've seen it when we've been running VMs on older versions of decisions. But let's see. Let's just see what this thing can think of. I have seen that. So let me think about where I saw that and how we can get rid of it. Who else is that is that Jeremy in here by any chance, or is that Jared?
Yes, it's me.
Hey, do you remember when we were working in the VMs on our movie theater project, we had that red editor. Do you remember what the path to resolve that was? If you don't, I can kind of play around with it.
I believe, I don't remember if, I think we might have upgraded,
You
like
might have updated.
updated to a
Yeah.
higher version.
Okay. Is there any way that you have access to that URL by any chance, Jeremy? You can send it to me. If you don't have it, I can probably look for it too. I just wonder.
No, I don't have it at the moment.
All right, no problem, man. No problem. Let's see if I can find it real quick. But yes, BT, I have seen that one. Movie theater build. Give me just one moment, VT. I'm going to see if I can get into that VM again. And if I can, I'm just going to see if I can resolve it. If not, I can almost certainly ask Jared because he would know. But he is in another meeting setting up some QuickBooks stuff across the room. Speaking of Quick, it is. I'm almost there, folk. And if you're just joining as well, I see we got more and more people joining as we kind of go. If you have questions, feel free to let me know. It's 10.10.11. Okay. 10.10. 11.11. Oh, now here's the real question. What are the odds I can actually log into this, huh? Probably none. Probably no chance I can log into this. I'll give it one more try here, and if I can't figure it out, I do know it's that. Yeah. VT, it might be something I'll have to get back to you. I have seen that message. It has to do with updating. You are right. Yeah, thank you, Jeremy. I tried that one. That was my first one. Yeah. Oh, nope. Speak of the no, I'm wrong. Okay. Yeah, there we go. Thank you. You're a man. You're the man. Appreciate you. Jeremy to the rescue. Yeah, so if I go into flows, I don't want to mess with this too much, actually. I think Jeremy's right that we might have updated it to get rid of it. VT, can you pull what version or can you pull what version you're in into the chat to me real fast when you get a chance? We're an A2. We personally are an A21 for this particular instance. And then Shankay, I got your question as well. All right, I'm writing this down. 817. Okay, thank you, man. I will send you an email. I have it locked in. I will ask Mr. Jared when he works his way through. Or I'll ask someone who is in dev or something, and they'll give me the real answer on that one. So we had another question. So I'm gonna kind of just move on just because I don't know the answer and I don't wanna hold anybody hostage here. So the question I got is, can decisions run an SQL or SQL statement we create during the runtime? I believe so. As I am looking for an easier way to do the mapping when generate a list for insert data into database table. Yeah, I think that's possible, especially for the data was in a vertical layout. I'll unmute you and we'll kind of just do some speculating here. I'm sure there's a way to do it, but we're gonna have to stumble into it together here. Let me see.
Hello.
Yep, I can hear you. Yeah, you sound great.
So normally we have an Excel file as the data. Then the data is listed in the horizontal way. So that means the first row is a column name. Then the following rows is the data. But recently we got our Excel file template. Part of it, we need to put into a table, we need to load into a table, but it is the column name is in the vertical, is all in the one column in the vertical way. Then the data is in the last column. So I don't know how to do that mapping. I can read the whole Excel file into a list. Then I have a database table ready for be inserted. So I have I need to generate a list in the table
in the table definition data structure. So I need to mapping this to.
Okay. Yeah, let's take a look at it. And VT, I don't know if you see on the screen here. But this is what it when I fed your question into the documentation, or the doc bot, this is what I got. So maybe this is something you can try. And maybe that'll resolve the issue for you. And it's kind of crazy that it has that level of depth. This is for VT's previous question, just hopefully. And again, I just copy and pasted the question you typed it into here. I also typed in yours, Sean. Okay. All right. So I'm getting a lot of stuff in the chat about raw SQL. You can use raw SQL step to create any SQL statement you want. So let's kind of mess with that for a moment and see if we can. I'm not going to do it in here. I'm going to delete this. All right, back to my local here. All right, let's go. Nope, not Project Alpha. Let's go into Lunch and Learn and see if we can mess around with that raw SQL step. I'm not super familiar with it myself personally, but I'm willing to learn here on the Lunch and Learn. So we'll call this raw SQL. Boom. This is a searchable step. Nope, that's a flow. And again, I made the same mistake I made 5 minutes ago. I named the flow the same thing as a step. So when I, when I named that flow, it shows up as a searchable tool. So that's confusing. Bad practice by me. But here we are, raw SQL step. I'm getting some documentation links here. Let's open this. Here we go. So, I did get this from people on our end, as well as people outside of our organization said, "Hey, be careful." They said, "Just be careful." So, here's the warning that I was told, advised to kind of give you. Warning: the raw SQL step requires an advanced ability to write and understand SQL queries. It does not sanitize inputs, which introduces the potential for SQL injection vulnerabilities. Each use of the step is treated as a separate call and could impact performance on systems with large SQL query call volumes. To learn how to hide this step, do this. So again, this step does exist, but a bunch of people are kind of advising. Someone's saying they missed the question, so I'll read it out loud to you again. The question that we got in its exact wording is this. Can decisions run a SQL statement we create during runtime, as I'm looking for an easier way to do the mapping when generating a list for data to insert into a database table? I did get a follow-up to that, and it said especially when the data was in a vertical layout. So these are the options that were kind of made by that doc bot. This is kind of the one that we, I guess this is the stuff that we ran or we're talking about. But again, as most people just kind of speculated, you just want to be really careful with it. The raw SQL step is just one of those things that when you're messing with your SQL database, you can break it. So I'm probably not going to actually run this flow in any capacity, as well as I don't think I have it set up. But you do have the ability over here to kind of, type some of this stuff out if you wanted to. But yeah, so you have that option. Okay, thank you. Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, you're very, very welcome. So someone said I might have missed part of the question, but it sounds like making a database structure from a CSV database stored may be an easy solution. Got some commentary on the side, which I'm always appreciative of. Missed part of the question, but make a database structure from CSV mapping. BT, can you give me a little bit more in the chat about what you think in that direction? It would just deserialize CSV to an entity and you save entities. Wow. I'll just de deserialize from CSV to entity and use save entities. Create data structure from CSV. Let's go. I'm gonna walk through this one at a time, man. I'm gonna create it. Well, I guess I would need the CSV though, huh? So someone in the chat who has a lot of technical background is saying we can create a type from CSV. And again, I don't have the CSV to kind of paste in here, but you can do that and then deserialize and then use save entities. So That might be helpful. It's not something I can really build out right here on the fly, unfortunately, just because it would just take me too long. So, but if you would like, I can maybe have somebody follow up with you, or really another great option, just because of the sensitivity of working in your SQL database. Probably this is a good option for like a support question, just so they can walk through it with you and kind of make sure that you're not doing anything that's too destructive or has too much permanence outside of the flow that you want to use that data. Because the last thing we want to do is kind of give you some advice here that's kind of half thought out, and then you go and trash your database. That would not be a good day for you or for me. But I think a support ticket, and I can, if you would like, I can help you submit that support ticket and attach this YouTube video so they have some context behind it. Whatever's easiest for you. Like I said, I just that's kind of outside the scope, something that I'd feel comfortable giving you YouTube content about. Any other questions in the chat? And again, if you Shankei, if you'd like me to submit a ticket for you, I gladly will, or if you know how to do it, it might be easier for you because you can explain it and flesh it out a little more than I can. But if you do submit a ticket, feel free to email trainingdecisions.com like, hey, I submitted a ticket, and then I'll see who got assigned to, and I will send them the YouTube video so they have some context behind it as well, if that's the best option. I'm just kind of still in love with the DocBot here, trying to break it here. See how far outside of decisions we can get here. I'll race a ticket, thanks. Let's see if we can break the DocBot. but it, yeah, it's again, this thing is really awesome. This is my first time. Hey, see, look, we're even outside of the decisions ecosystem. If you want to know about Super Bowl, decisions has got you there too. So. Cool. Yeah, I'm feeling pretty good. And then VT, I don't know if you saw, do you want me to, I'll put this in the chat for you just so, I guess you could go to DocBot and type in the exact same question, but I'll just put it in the chat for everybody. No, I won't. Will it not let me copy this? Maybe my paste is not working here. Maybe it's too long of a message. Yeah. Unfortunately, I think it's just too long of a message. But there it is on that one. Any more questions? I can kind of go back and finish up some of the stuff I was kind of talking about earlier. And again, unfortunately, I don't really have a lot of answers for you guys, but we can kind of bounce through a thing or two and then maybe call it just so we can get that ticket followed up on, get that video to whoever receives said ticket. All right, cool. I'm just going to do a couple more kind of flow throughs. Kind of back to the collection filter stuff. I saw that. Thank you anyways. I don't have access to the server, so we should better go through the upgrade process. Yes, probably. Would imagine that is the case. Let's see about let's we so we talked about we're, for those of you that kind of joined in a little bit, we're starting to kind of learn a little bit about rule collection filters because that's something I've been tasked with, kind of the nuances of it. When you do decide to move these flows, if you miss the front half, it does make a rule, or it makes a flow that's associated with it. So a collection filter is going to make a flow, a rule collection filter is going to make a rule, and those things kind of live in those folders as hidden items. So again, I have these four flows here of just various iterations. But if I go to folder view and show hidden, it's got all of these rule collection filters that need to be migrated when you do decide to move those flows. So another kind of performance hit on these steps is you kind of got to think of it in almost two capacities, that when you run data through one of these steps, it's actually kind of hitting two elements. It's hitting the step itself, and then it's hitting the rule that's associated with it. And, and across a small number of iterations and a small number of data going through it, you're not going to see a huge thing. But if you're running thousands of records through, many, many rule collection filters, or many, many collection filters, sorting, things along those lines, you can run into some issues there. The last thing I think I'll show you, oh no, I don't have it installed yet. I don't have 9.3. I was going to show you some cool 9.3 stuff, but I don't have it for you just quite yet. With 9.3 though, which we just, I think it's live at this point. Jasmine, do you know if 9.3 is live? By any chance? I guess I can look here. Nope, it's still not. So with 9.3 coming out, we have some really great stuff, especially if you are a Postgres user. We've resolved some issues and you have a huge performance boost in 9.3 for Postgres users. We are introducing a whole bunch of new AI tools and modules and comparisons and easy hookups to kind of the big name brands in that space. With 9.3 as well, there's a really great, there's a lot of, I think there's new converters. I believe in 9.2 we had some new converters as well. So if I remember correctly, yeah. So with 9.2, there are some really great converters that are new as well. So like in previous iterations with decisions, let's say you wanted to pad strings and join them together, like you'd have to run individual steps to do that. We now have a converter that can do both of those things for you. So here under converters, we have pad string list and join, which will let you kind of, merge a bunch of steps really into one converter. So it'll save you from having to kind of populate your flow with steps that can just be done with a single converter now. You're not going to want to edit the converter here, but you'll want to input that data here. So it'll give you the option to say, hey, what is the string list? Remove extra items if it's as a Boolean. So if it makes a constant, it's a checkbox now. The join strings character, the pad list character, the desired string length. So you can pad things, you can join them, all as a part of a singular converter. I do believe that that is the only new one for 9.2. I also, kind of looping back to what we always talk about, sorry for hitting you with it. I also made a video personally of the 9.2 new features, which is really fairly robust. It is right here, new features and enhancements, 9.2. So as we kind of go through a lot of new process mining stuff as well. If you're big into process mining, there's lots of great process mining steps in 9.2. List of dynamic rows to CSV Excel conversion. You can do that for all different types. Look at that, CSV, Excel SX, and auto select CSV. All of our query editors have been updated in 9.2 to kind of match the visual and workflow that you're used to with like a SQL editor for queries. We've kind of really simplified it and made it a lot more similar to what you might experience in other applications. So that's for query editors, that we have new icons. That's for tables, maximize. We can change the size of those screens. 9.2, awesome. Another great feature. Look at this. When searching for something, like rules, right? It'll let you say, what project do you want to search in and what type of thing do you want to search for? So it gives you better searching options here in 9.2. Another great feature for you. We've kind of changed the project migration dashboard. We've removed some things that were kind of filtering it. New calculated column. Sure. Another question. I have Davis connection creating decisions, and there are some steps created automatically for update the table. One is update connection table name. The other is update values for list connection table name. What is the difference? Good question. Again, unfortunately. Let's feed it into our little thing here. What you got to say about that, DocBot? We'll see what they got to say about that. So when you create a database connection in decisions or step creator, one is update connection.tablename and the other is update values for list connection table name. What's the difference? And if anyone in the room has some insight to that while we're kind of waiting on that, I can look through documentation, but to be straight up honest with you, I do not know. My guess is going to be, yeah, my guess is going to, this is a guess, and hopefully maybe somebody in the chat's got the answer. Can I set the condition for it like where sub statement? Ooh. So again, for the folks that might be on this side of the line, I might have some insight for me. We're looking for something along the lines of update connection.table name and the others update values for list. My guess is that the first one, the update connection.table name, is going to allow you to change how you connect to that table and like in the capacity in which the table is actually connected to decisions and when you made that database connection. The other one is going to be able to allow you to parse down and update values for a list within that connection. And then can I set the condition for it, like where substatement? That is a good question. Oh, here you go. Man, this thing is so insanely beast. Here you go. So that is the difference between the two. I feel like I'm just a chatbot feeder these days. Talk about taking people's jobs, you know what I mean? Can I set the condition for it like a where statement? Let's see if it builds us out. Man. Yeah, you can. So again, I hate to be the guy that says let's Google it, but it looks like you can. Again, this is just something outside of the scope I know a lot about. And if you're just joining, I see we get more people as we kind of go. This is docbot.decisions.com. It's brand new. I think it launched today. But this thing is crazy good. I mean, really shockingly good. So in the step properties, locate the where clause field. So hopefully that gives you some information. And again, apologies, I don't have much to elaborate on that, because again, it's with these integrations, by the time I set up an integration and try to update the values, I don't want to break anything on my default because I got stuff I'm working on. But this is hopefully a little bit helpful for you, kind of just feeding the AI bot here. Any other final questions? Maybe something that I can answer without using the AI bot. I could use a layup here, like how do I create a flow? But I'm fine with just living this way as well. Any final questions before we kind of get this thing wrapped up? We did 40 minutes. We talked a lot. And again, I think the most valuable learning opportunity we had here is that the DocBot fully is a great tool for you. Any final questions? All right, I'm going to wrap this thing up then. I appreciate everyone for joining today. Thank you, Jasmine, Jeremy, for the help. Thank you, VT, for the help. Thank you, VT, for the questions. Thank you, everybody, for joining. We will see you guys tomorrow with Mr. Jared Rodriguez. No, we got to follow up. I won't close out yet. I'll stick with you. But I can't find the set condition in the update values for list connection table step at all. Okay. All right, let's find it. Let's do it. Let's take a look. I know that on this, I've got some database tables. I just have to figure out which I can do here without breaking anything. Number one thing I'm trying to do here is not break something. What flows do we have here that I can just use? Flow one. Probably nothing in here. Yeah, of course. Set condition for update values list for connection table at all. Okay, where are those steps located at? I'm sure it's not just a searchable. It's probably under integration database. Where are you finding those steps?
think inside the integration. I don't know which version you are in at the moment. I'm in the nine. So
Yeah, I'm in eight. The only reason why I jump back over to eight is because I know I at least have database table, a database connection set up for this this instance. I don't have any on my local, which is my version nine. So you said it's under integration, huh?
yeah, it is the integration and the collection.
Oh, is it an internal service? Call an internal service?
No.
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 I don't know whether it's similar things in the nine is after we set up the database collection, then add the table, then some steps will automatically generate in the this here, the integration
Yeah. So you
inside
said,
the database,
yeah.
then they should have some table.
And it might just be that we have the right. Oh, ins.
Update. Yes.
Let's go. All right. So we're trying to figure out. I can't find the set conditions and the update values for list. Update values for list.
So, I mean, for the properties setting.
And step properties locate the where clause field. That seems pretty straightforward. Locate the where clause field. You are right. I am also not seeing the where clause field. It wouldn't be under step information. That is almost certain. I'm gonna see if I just feed it a random string list, if it populates that field. And like, I have any string lists here? Guess I just put in a random string list. Now we're looking for where. Building an array is not gonna do it. It's just gonna expand that. There's some transaction data. That's probably not it though. Transaction data, build data. Nope, it's not under that. Yeah, I'm with you on the where clause. And could this just be a nine only feature? Is that a possibility? You said it wasn't showing up on your nine either, though.
No.
Yeah. Yeah, I just don't have anything on nine. All right, I'm looking at another second here. So it's not going to be an outcome because we're trying to change some input information. Update values for list. Set the connection to the database you created. Provide the columns that need to be updated. In the step properties, locate the where clause field. Ain't no way it's going to give me that one. IDs to update is a list of unique keys of rows to update. Yeah, it just seems like if documentation. What is the name of this step again? I've got a million tabs at this point. I'm gonna start closing out stuff. Update values for list. They're saying if you want to update not based on unique keys, IDs to update is a list of unique keys of rows to update. If you want to update not based on unique keys, you should create a parameterized query. And then you're following up with my understanding is a need to create the list for update, just like the insert step. Yeah, I am at a loss here. Create the list for update just like the insert step. Nothing is jumping out at me. And maybe it's one of those things where we, when you set up your table, we gotta give the option for that. That's my guess after reading this is that, like sometimes with like repository actions, you need to enable repository actions, not just connect to the repository. And maybe there's something like that, like this. Like, see how it says, in addition to the standard steps created through table integration, starting in 9.3, though. Customers can create custom steps. This functionality is very simple to how access patterns works. The where clause is IDs to update. The where clause is IDs to update. I don't even see IDs to update though. Oh, right here. So this is your where clause, according to someone in the chat. The IDs to update is a unique keys of rows to update. So okay, I'm getting it now. Thank you for making the connections for me, Jasmine, VT, everybody, y'all rule. The where clause is the IDs to update. So it's a that's gonna be a list of unique keys and rows to update. If you want to update not based on unique keys, you got to create a parameterized query. So the where clause, according to the folks in here, is going to be with this IDs to update, but it's not going to be as simple as typing out like the actual query itself. You're going to have to fetch those unique keys in some capacity and feed it into this. So you'll have to fetch the ones that you want to update, and then you can pass those unique keys into that. So it's about as far into that as I am going to be able to get. Sorry about not coming to a clean closure there, but again, maybe somebody on support, I feel bad for doing that, but that might be the best one for you. But for now, we're going to run it back to Mars, Jared, who is one of the smartest folks we know. So some of these big questions he might be able to kind of resolve as well, if we can't get any further. But again, please check out this docbot.decisions.com. It rules. So I'm going to go ahead and end the session for now. If you have any questions, like I said, or if you want help with anything, feel free to reach out. In older versions, you can fetch entities based on, so you need to use XXX step first, then the update step. Yep, exactly. You're very welcome. And I appreciate you just joining and asking questions because I'm learning too. I'm learning while I lunch. So in older versions, you can fetch entities based on your criteria and then update. Yeah. So in older versions, you can fetch entities based on your criteria. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, so you would fetch the entities based on the criteria. You'd add fetch criteria in there to get out only the ones that you want. And then from there, you should be able to get a list of those unique identifiers and pass it into that step so that you can update those in that capacity. So, all right, folks. Thank you very much. We did about an hour. We will see you tomorrow. I'll be in the lobby tomorrow, but it'll be Jared hosting it. So thank you guys very much. If you have any more questions, feel free to reach out to trainingdecisions.com, and we can kind of get some eyes on it. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of your day.